The big issue right now is guns, something that you've gotten so much attention for, this position to take away AR-15s, AK-47s. How do you actually do that? Is that a constitutional amendment? Is that an executive order? Is that a bill passed by Congress? How do you do it?
We do it. As a country, we decide that the lives of our fellow Americans, especially our kids, who far too often are hunted down in their classrooms, in the hallways of their schools, are the most important thing. And we're gonna make sure that we protect your Second Amendment right to have a gun, to hunt, to protect yourself in your home, but that there is no right to own a weapon of war, an AR-15 or an AK-47 that was designed and engineered to kill people as effectively, as efficiently as possible on a battlefield. I'm listening not just to Democrats on this, but Republicans, non-gun owners and gun owners alike, including owners of AR-15s, and they by and large agree that this is what we should do as a country. So I expect Americans to comply with the law. Those who own AR-15s will understand that surrendering those weapons is in the best interests of our fellow Americans and making sure that we address an epidemic of gun violence that takes more than 40,000 lives a year.
But is that a law that you pass? Is that something you just put out there? I mean, how do you actually get this done?
It's a law that would be passed by the American people through their representatives in Congress, a law which I would sign and a law which I would enforce. We've seen this happen in other countries. Australia had a mandatory buyback of AR-15s and AK-47s after a deadly mass shooting there. And it's estimated that 16 mass shootings have been prevented since that law has been adopted. We know that we can do this. We just have to show the political will, reflect the public sentiment that's alive and well in America right now, importantly being led by young people like March for Our Lives and everyday Americans like Moms Demand Action, who are going to make sure that they are more than a match for the NRA.
You know, the NRA though would say that this is illegal to do it. It's against the Constitution. They will likely sue over something like this. We've seen their lawsuits over and over again. How do you fight this in court, especially with the Supreme Court that has a lot of conservatives on it right now?
Yeah. If we are afraid of the NRA, if we allow our fear of the courts to keep us from moving, then we are complicit in the gun deaths and the violence that we've seen. Justice Scalia opined from the Supreme Court that the Second Amendment right is not an absolute one, that there are some common sense constraints like keeping weapons of war out of the hands of our fellow Americans. No one would argue that you should have a grenade launcher or be able to drive a tank down the street. This AR-15, and you can take it from the words of the man who designed it himself, was not intended for civilian use. The ability to kill people in record numbers, to impose a kind of suffering and harm that's hard for us to imagine unless we've experienced it, is not something that we should accept in this country. And I refuse to accept it, and I won't allow fear of the NRA, any corporation, any political interest, to keep me from doing the right thing. I'm going to stand up for my fellow Americans.
El Paso, when that shooting happened, how did that change you as a man? How did that change you as a candidate?
El Paso showed me the real cost and consequence of Donald Trump. That, you know, a racism and a violence that had been alive and well in this country from the very beginning of this country was welcomed out into the open and directed at El Paso, Texas. I mean, this is the president who said Mexicans are rapists and criminals, who warned of invasions and infestations and killers and predators. And then when someone at one of his rallies in May said, shoot them, when referring to immigrants, the president smiled and laughed. He said this was okay to do. And a killer with an AK-47 drove 600 miles and came to El Paso, really directed that way by the president of the United States. It changed me because it told me that we can no longer keep quiet. We can no longer fail to call things for what they are. We can no longer meet this threat with anything less than the urgency that it deserves. And that's the way that I've been speaking. That's the way I've been bringing my fellow Americans into this. And that's the way that we're going to affect the change that we want to see.
And last question. We talked to you earlier about homelessness. You're also talking about criminal justice reform today. On the issue of marijuana, should marijuana be illegal in the United States?
Marijuana should be legal in the United States. Never again should one of our fellow human beings be locked up for possession of something that's already legal in more than half the states in the country. And furthermore, we should expunge the arrest records for those caught in possession of that substance. And then I think we have to go a step further and address the issue of equity. disproportionately, African Americans have been locked up for possession of something that all Americans use at a roughly the same rate. We need to make sure that when it comes to marijuana-based businesses and entrepreneurship, there's an even shot at success for those who've borne the brunt of a criminal justice system that is patently unfair.
And just to wrap things up, on our show last week, Bob Schrum, the political strategist, said that during the debates you were Beto Unchained. Our debate focus group said that you won over everybody else. They were most impressed by you. They weren't even thinking of voting for you, and now they are thinking of voting for you. Do you feel a sense of relief that you're sort of finally just doing things the way you want to do them? Is that a change for you?
My job's going to be to see things as clearly as I can, to speak as honestly as I can, and to be as decisive as possible about the solution. So on gun violence, it means being honest about the fact that universal background checks and red flag laws and into the sale of weapons of war are good steps, but are insufficient. And so we'll say the politically difficult but absolutely necessary thing that we need to buy those weapons back. On our drug laws, we'll talk about the changes that we need to make, including ending for-profit prisons and cash bail. We'll talk about a racism that infects every single part of American life, including our economy and healthcare and education, and how we need to address that by having every single American tell their story, by doing so telling the full American story. This is the kind of conversation we need to have as a country, the kind of conversation I'm grateful to be leading as a candidate for the presidency.
That'll work. Thank you so much
Thank
for
you.
The time. Yeah, really appreciate it.